would be very happy to talk about the interventions for central venous disease, which has been one of my pet subject, and how to deal with it practically. So what I propose to do is to divide my talk onto these topics: when to suspect central venous stenosis, how to evaluate, how to assess the severity of obstruction, and how to decide on lesions which require intervention, when to abandon the excess and tight IV fistula in presence of venous hypertension, and when can nephrologists do it, and when do you need the help of interventional radiologist or somebody else. And I'll in the end give a couple of small video demonstrations to show you what can be achieved by doing a good venoplasty intervention, stenting, etc. So let me begin by asking a question. Have you ever seen a patient with thoracic venous obstruction that confirms the passage of catheter or causes swelling or other symptoms? I mean, isn't it very frustrating that you take up somebody for insertion of a temporary or even a tunnel cuff catheter, and then suddenly you find that your guide wire is getting stuck? This is a experience which I'm sure all of us have faced over a period of time on several occasions. So what are these central veins we are talking about? So as we define, so anything beyond this first rib on either side and anything which is at this point of internal jugular veins. So this area constitutes central vein as far as the upper extremity is concerned. For lower extremity, there are different definitions. So have you seen this kind of a hand? Okay, there's no mark for that. Obviously, this is a central venous stenosis. So over a period of time, we have had seen various kinds of hands. And then of that, we have to not think about central venous stenosis, but if you look at the hand carefully, this seems to be more of a venous hypertension type of a problem. Or this kind of swelling on the left side panel. So this is obviously not, so many multiple veins, there could be an obstruction somewhere. But look at here, there is not only swelling, but there is also blackness of the finger. And see this fistula, which is the vein, which is going probably crossover from brachial to cephalic to brachial vein, going all the way wherever it can go to. So we have seen also or this side of a problem where there is a swelling fistula is in use, but if you look at it carefully, there are tortuous and dilated veins. So this is definitely a problem related to central vein. So we can find out, and then of course this kind of swellings which are not related to central vein problem. So in general, what I'm trying to say is that physical examination is very, very crucial. It should be done before every use or at least weekly, starting with first use of fistula or even prior to that. We have to follow the principle of look, listen and feel. It's an art not always taught or learned enough, and I've had the fortune to learn from my friends both Tushar and Anil about the importance of physical examination of AV fistula, and that is where you will be able to pick up more of problems related to malfunctioning of AV fistula. So you have to inspect for central veins. You have to inspect for central venous stenosis in equal swelling of the two arms. Then of course you have to look for evidence of ischemia, cyanosis of the fingers or blackness of fingers. So all those problems have to be looked into carefully. And then of course for the central venous stenosis, there is this arm raising test. So this is
sir, now you can unmute yourself, sir. Yeah.
Yes, Hemant, carry on.
Sir, unmute yourself, sir. We can't hear you.
Hemant.
Okay, hello. Can you hear me?
Your screen is okay. You come to slideshow.
Okay.
Yeah. Yes.
Okay, now can you see the video? So if you raise the,
yes.
So this is the hand raising test where you, if you raise the hand, the vein should collapse completely, and when you bring it down, the vein fills up again. If you can get this, this is a test which tells you that there is no narrowing from the circuit, in the circuit of AV fistula, starting from the body of the fistula, that is the anastomotic side, all the way up to SVC. Okay, so this hardly takes few seconds and that should be done. So let's come to central venous disease and how. Sure, all of you can then visit it and examine it, which basically includes look, feel, listen, augmentation test and arm raising test, and that can be accomplished within a minute. So if the staff is trained on that, they will be the first people to point it out to you, and then they will be able to guide that patient to the nephrologist. Of course, if you have services of vascular access coordinator, which is not so much prevalent in our country, that is of course more appropriate approach, but that does not happen at all the centers. So diagnosis is based on history as well as examination. So as I said, previous history of catheter placements, etc. And then if you have excess dysfunction, decreased flow, increased venous pressure, history of excessive bleeding from the puncture site after removal of needle, of course, these all point towards having central vein stenosis. On examination, there will be numerous dilated collateral veins in the neck or chest or arm edema, dilated or just draining veins of the fistula itself on the side of the central venous stenosis. In case of bilateral innominate vein or superior vena cava stenosis or occlusion, patient may present with superior vena cava syndrome with severe breathlessness at times, and it can often be diagnosed with an absence of normal respiratory variation in the diameter of central vein and polyphasic atrial waves. But it is difficult to visualize the central veins with duplex ultrasound in obese and muscular patients. So basically, what I'm trying to say is that Doppler is not a very, very reliable method. You may suspect it, but ultimately you'll have to do something more. But before that, you have to also remember that central vein stenosis can mimic, something can mimic central vein stenosis, and that is something coming from the external compression, which could be a rib, which could be a collateral vein, which could be an arch of an aorta, etc. And those things have to be also kept in mind, because in those situations, if you try to do angioplasty of the vein, that will not help unless the external source is taken. Diagnostic value of CT. So when will you do the CT? Will you do CT in every case where you suspect central venous stenosis? Just try and remember that CT scan or an MRI is just diagnostic. Gold standard is digital subtraction angiography of the vein, because it not only tells you the exact picture, but you, in case you need an intervention, you can do it at the same sitting. So if you are worried or not sure about what is the likely problem, that you go for this computerized venography, and you can also see deep and superficial vein, which DSM may not be able to pick up, and also what are the other surrounding anatomical structure, and whether there is any external compression or not. And yes, when you want to have a proper diagnosis, I'll show you one case. So we have several cases where we have done CT and MRI prior to proceeding with an intervention. But basically, if you suspect a very severe problem, it is always a good idea to have venous mapping, and that is where this procedure might have to be done. So, for example, this patient had a tunnel cuff catheter, and she came with symptoms which were suggestive of SVC stenosis. And then when we did this, if you can make out, it's definitely the tip of the catheter is at the SVC RA junction. There is a narrowing there, and then there is this thrombus which is sitting at the tip of it. And not only that, when we reconstructed the image, what you see is that this is the catheter, this is the acute thrombus surrounding the tip of the catheter, the stenosis below this at the SVC RA junction was seen in the previous film. But if you see this multiple other collaterals, that means there has been a chronic obstruction. So there is a chronic obstruction, acute obstruction, there is a thoracic inlet syndrome or SVC syndrome. So a lot of things can be diagnosed by carefully doing the CT, telling the CT grapher that look what I am looking for, so that he can reconstruct the images. So you sit down with him, look at various frames, reconstruct it, and you will be able to get to a diagnosis which can be then helpful in planning for a proper intervention. Sometimes MRV is a valuable technique, and it is of course non-invasive, and if you do it with what is called as time of flight protocol, you don't need gadolinium, and you get really good pictures as seen here. If you see on the left side, this is the left IJV, and if you see, there is a narrowing here which has been reported, and then we had to take this patient for a left IJV tunnel cuff catheter insertion, and exactly clinical pathological correlation. The narrowing was there at same spot which was pointed out by the MRI. We did the balloon angioplasty, and we could easily insert the left IJV tunnel catheter. So if you encounter central venous stenosis, then what are your options? Of course, there are surgical options, but endovascularly, you can do angioplasty, you can do stenting, then there could be stenting for failed angioplasty at a later date, whether to use stent grafts, whether to consider primary stenting or reserve it for a secondary stage, and then whether you can also do flow reduction techniques by surgically or balloon-assisted bending of the AV fistula, which cases where we should do this and not plan to do primary gingivoplasty. So those are the several factors which will have to be considered before jumping on to doing a procedure and just do an angiography and angioplasty. So this is one small video of 2 minutes, which was presented on the podium at ASTN meeting, and I would like to just run through it, and that will tell you as to. So here is a story of a person who had brachiocephalic stenosis, and okay, so 60-year-old diabetic, 3 hemodialysis, and through right brachiocephalic AV fistula. One minute. This gets a. Okay, so this is the fistula. You see, the hand is swollen. And then somebody is dialyzing it, and then there has been a venous aneurysm at the puncture site. So, and this patient has facial swelling, ptosis, diminished hearing, papilledema, redness of pinna, and hemifacial swelling, the redness and dilated veins on the chest wall. So everything which can occur and go wrong with a fistula because of the central venous stenosis is there in this case. And then with this, we could visualize that what could be the problem. We did a Doppler. So first and foremost, you must realize that this is a high flow fistula. So whether that is responsible for this patient's problem, or whether there is any other problem in the central veins. So we did examine them, and we did find abnormal waveforms in the jugular and subclavian vein. And then we decided that we will go for some sort of intervention in this particular patient. So we did angiography, and because in such a situation, it is always better to visualize the whole arterial and venous circuit. And that's why we punctured the right femoral artery, because we don't know where are we going to be heading for. And see. Okay, so this is the arterial shoot with venous return. Okay, so see the venous return. Okay, the venous return is coming. But if you see, there are a lot of flow. And this is the high flow fistula. Then we punctured the right femoral vein. And you see that there is a stenosis here, which has been passed with this wire. And there is a retrograde flow into these veins because of the obstruction there in the right brachiocephalic vein. So high pressure, large size balloon is almost 12 by 40 balloon. And you have dilated it, and you again do a check angio. But you see the residual stenosis is still present. There is a request. So you do a second plasty, mostly with the same balloon. Again, you will do a check angio, and still the same poor result. So this is the situation where you will decide to put a stent. Otherwise, you don't. So this is how the stent is being deployed. And as you are deploying the stent, you just be sure, so you keep on injecting dye and make sure that your stent is getting placed in a proper point of time, making sure that you are not going to obstruct the blood flow coming from the left brachiocephalic vein, because if that happens, your left side vascular excess will just go away. Once you have put the stent, you always do a in-stent plasty and then do a check angio. And this is how, and now see the results. Everything has disappeared within 48 hours. Nice vein is seen, which can be used as for the dialysis purpose. And you can appreciate the smile on his face. So this could be the, so stenting need not be done initially, but if there is a elastic recoil, as it happened in this case which I showed, or later on after 3 months patient or within 3 months patient comes back with the same stenosis, that is the time when you will think about putting it in a stent. Now, can the nephrologist do it himself? Yes, if you have the knowledge about the type of things required, like introducing needle, vascular sheets, catheter, guide wires, balloons, and stent, and then you have basic training in interventional nephrology, including ultrasound training, if you have an access to cath lab. CM is fine if you are just going to insert the tunnel catheter and EAPD catheter insertion. If you have good rapport and backup of interventional radiologists, that is very good. But majority of the centers, as I understand, not in the A town, but lesser than A towns, is the IRs are just not available, or there might be one person who is too busy. And I know quite a few of my friends in India who have taken help of interventional cardiologists and started the program, and they are very happy and successful in their approach now, and they are doing it independently. In fact, if you know Dr. Gerald Bethard, who is considered the father of interventional nephrology, he himself went to cardiologists way back in, I think, 1983, to and learned as a nephrologist from a cardiologist the method, and then he started it, and the whole world has followed it. So there is nothing, no harm taking help of cardiologists if you don't have access of interventional radiologists. So if you are dealing with a simple problem, then maybe you can do it. Like as you see this, so this patient came with right. You see there is a swelling break. This is the cephalic arch, and there is the narrowing there. So wire is passed across the, because this is not a complete narrowing. If you do the balloon angioplasty and then you do more of it, and then see the shouldering of the balloon means there is that tight stenosis over there. The thing is dilated, and then you do a check angio. See that stenosis has disappeared. So these are simple procedures which I'm sure once you are trained into this, how to handle the wires and how to get across the stenosed venous segments, not to begin with complete stenosis, or CTOs as we call it, but if this partial stenosis, you can definitely do it. So if there is a symptomatic thoracic central venous obstruction on the same side of hemodialysis, fistula, what would one do? I'm sure many a times we have had this situation where the dialysis is initiated on the right side IJV non-cuff catheter, which remains in place for definitely more than 15 days. A left-sided AV fistula is created, which fails, and then over a period of time, right-sided AV fistula is created by the surgeon without paying attention to the fact that that right side, there is already a non-cuffed catheter, and in long run, that is likely to cause central venous stenosis. So this is same story repeated in this particular gentleman. So right brachiocephalic AV fistula, and now has right arm swelling. So to begin with, he had a right IJV non-tuff tunnel catheter 6 months ago. It remained in place for 2 months. Then he has a right hand. He is right-handed. He is now disabled, because his right arm is swollen and his AV fistula has a blood flow of 1250, which is a right brachiocephalic fistula. It is being used for dialysis, but cannulation is difficult because of the swelling of the hand. Swelling has worsened over the past 3 months. He can no longer use his arm because he cannot brush, eat, or wear his shirt due to his wound. So in this is the angiography. Anybody would like to, Bala or Sampat, in such a situation, would we as nephrologists venture into do it ourselves, or we will need the help of an expert to cross over this obstruction. Would you like to answer that, or should I proceed?
Yeah, have you shown the angiogram? This is the
no. This is the only picture. Okay, so if it's a first attempt to treat this patient's problem, the plan would be to cross it and place a stent. Maybe yes, maybe no. We don't know. We'll decide it on table. Approach from the upper. Now, many a times you have to know what is called as excess and groin approach. So we will go with one catheter, which will go from the right hand vein, which is definitely very well matured, and it will be easy to go to the target lesion, and then come also from the groin, and that might be helpful in patients who have venous hypertension and central vein. And then once I cross, I would do a serial angioplasty and then decide if there is elastic recoil. But as I said, don't jail the left brachiocephalic vein, and consider decompressing the outlet with a clavicle removal or first rib resection. That will be, of course, decided by vascular. Just do a flow reduction technique, and that might just reduce the swelling, and fistula could still be. So if this is unsuccessful, cross the lesion, dilate it sufficient enough, and just put the tunnel cuff catheter, close the brachiocephalic fistula, and run for a left-sided AV fistula. So that could be another option available to us, that just give up this fistula because you have no scope to dilate the right-sided central vein system sufficient enough for the fistula to remain patent and working, because very likely that right-sided central venous stenosis will keep on coming back. And in the same approach, whether you can use herograft if it was available, but to do that also, one will have to probably first close the existing fistula, and then that can be done either surgically or endovascularly. And now there is a new device called a surfacer inside out for this type of CTOs, wherein you go in from inside and pierce the vein through and through, come out from the neck, and you can insert your tunnel catheter through that also. So Society of Interventional Radiology has come out with this thoracic complete venous obstruction reporting standard. So if there is this type of complete stenosis, and this now been available as guidelines, and they have divided it into type 1, type 2, type 3. So this is like type 2 CTVO, and there was this central vein work group, which was formed in 2015, which included people from all specialties, and they worked for nearly 3 years to develop SIR-TCVO reporting standards. And this is like type 3, so obviously in this type of situations with a vagus vein filling because SVC is stenosed, and in such a situation we will definitely need the help of some experts to tackle this sort of a problem. And then, as I said, there is type 1, type 2, type 3, type 4, and this is the picture. This is available in the article in Journal of Vascular Interventional Radiology. For those who are interested, can go through it. And then they have also given this reporting standards, where you, whenever you report a central venous stenosis, you should mention about anatomy, flow, symptoms, duration of symptoms, signs, performance status, anatomy pattern of TCVO, and impact of TCVO on patient care. So this is now all getting standardized, and I will end by just this last, second last slide to tell you that in case in future, if we have to talk, first, we should be talking about drug-coated balloons, which are not so widely used, but there are now several reports coming in with large size balloons available in drug coated balloon category. So that whether that will be helpful to tackle central venous stenosis could be one topic for the future. And now what is coming up in a very big way is the intravenous ultrasound. So like as shown here, so if you have a stenosis and you do plasty, you think everything is fine. But if you look at the IVUS picture, this is the pre-angioplasty and this is post-angioplasty. Same thing with all those muck sitting inside the vein. And then when you put a stent, now the venous lumen. So from external, what appears to be absolutely nice and fine need not be the same from the inside, and that's where you need to do IVUS. So this could be one thing in future where we as a nephrologist will be making use of this more and more to be able to accurately diagnose and treat the central venous lesions. So thank you very much. Thank you, Interventional Nephrology. And all those who are interested, this is my commentary on Indian Journal of Nephrology. You can read on that, central venous stenosis, what should a nephrologist know? And this is something published just last month in July. This is the link. If you click, can copy and click on this link, it will lead you to a chapter, and there is a free download available, so you can read it at your leisure. And I would request, if in any case you are not able to get this link, contact one of your BARD representatives and they can pass it on to you. So, Bala, I end here. Thank you very much, all of you, for your presence.
Thank you. Thank you, Hemant. It was a great presentation. I think there will be a lot of things to be clarified from you, but I think we'll quickly take up Dr. Velaravind, who has very enthusiastically prepared his talk on AV fistula.